This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Door of Dread, a Secret Service Romance. Author: Arthur Stringer. Year: 1916. Chapter 1. What's your name? Sadie Wimple. And your home? Anywhere under me, hat. The heavy-jowled man with the incongruously alert side glance looked up across the polished desktop. What do you mean by that? That me home's mostly where I happen to be. He studied her with an eye as wistful as an old hound's eye in winter. She looked as dapper and neat, in her trim-cut tailor-made gown, as a well-groomed polo pony. And under her neatness of limb was a suggestion of strength, and under her strength a trace of audacity, and under that audacity a touch of restiveness. Have you ever been in Europe?
Sure.
Where? About all over the lot, was the languid response. I asked you where. Well, Odessa, Budapest, Palermo, Petersburg, Rome, the Riviera, Paris, Ostend, Amsterdam, the...
That'll do, cut in the man at the desk.
Quite some little pilgrim, ain't I? The trim-figured young woman in the Bendel hat had the effrontery to ask. The man at the desk fingered a paperweight fashioned from an old coin die of the Philadelphia Mint. Supposing you tell me what you know about this Fletcher report leak, he quietly suggested. There was a rustle of silk as Sadie Wimple crossed her knees. Admiral Fletcher roped out a Navy report showing how and why a foreign fleet could land in the United States. Centaur Lodge submitted that report to the Senate. But before doing it, he told them the report ought to be printed in confidence, as they put it, and the motion was carried. Secretary Daniels, UC, didn't want any foreign guy getting next to the data in that report. It'd be like advertising your safe combination, too.
I know all that.
Well, there was a certain foreign guy got hold of that report.
Who was it?
A capper for Kudel.
But who?
The same capper that got hold of our secret signal code book from the destroyer hull last summer.
How do you know that?
Because I'm a friend of a friend of a friend of the boob, of an ensign who gave up the book and faced a court-martial for it a few weeks ago on the Oregon.
Where was the Oregon when that court-martial was held?
Anchored in San Francisco Bay, was the girl's answer. For a moment or two, Chief Blinn of the Secret Service stared out of the broad window of the Treasury Building. Just beyond that window was the Washington Monument, and behind that the Bureau of Engraving and Printing, where the electric elevators were rising and dipping with their afternoon crowds, and into B Street was swarming a motley throng of designers and engravers and plate printers, side by side with stitchers and counters and sizers, with steel pressmen and bull gangers and oil burners from the ink mill, all hurrying homeward after the day's work. They were part of a machinery which took on a touch of nobility because of its labyrinthine intricateness, because of its sheer unguessed complexities. Yet they were a mere company in that vast army which Chief Blinn and his agents were appointed both to appraise and protect. And they brought home, to the haggard-eyed official so meditatively watching them, a hint of the more immediate complications confronting him. You said you'd done Secret Service work before, he asked as he turned back to the girl.
Yes.
Where?
In Europe.
Anywhere else?
Right here in America.
For whom?
For you.
The chief looked ponderously up from the papers in which he had pretended to be so pertinaciously interested. It was an old trick of the chief's, that of masking his mental batteries behind an escarpment of manuscripts.
Then why haven't I a record of that work?
I guess you didn't know I was doing it.
Why?
Because I was acting for Kessner.
Of the Paris office?
Yes.
And with anybody else?
The girl hesitated.
Yes, with young Wilsnack as well.
The chief glanced down at his pages of script.
On what case?
The Lambert counterfeiting case.
Then why aren't you still acting with Kessner?
Because he's quitting the service.
Who told you that?
Wilsnock.
Does Wilsnock tell you everything he knows?
Sadie Wimple uncrossed her knees.
Not by a long shot.
But working together that way, the two of you naturally became more or less confidential?
A slight flush showed under the rice powder on the woman's sophisticated young face.
I was wise to Kessner's duck in the buggy long before Wilsnock ever opened his peep about it.
How did that happen?
Because I knew the skirt who was canning his professional chances by marrying him.
Does marriage always do that?
When a sleuth settles down, it ain't wise to stack too high on him staying the curly wolf of the singed cat crib.
The chief, puzzled for a moment or two over this apparently enigmatic statement.
Then it's Wilsnock you want to swing in with on this new work?
Not if I have to crowbar me way into it.
But why are you so sure you can help the service out in this case?
I never said I wanted to help the service out.
Then, what do you want to do?
I want O.C. Wilsnock make good.
For just a moment, a smile flickered about the face of the pendulous-jowled man at the desk. It made the watching girl think of heat lightning along an August skyline.
But how do you know Wilsnock is going to be put on this case?
Because he's the only man you've got who can round up that gang.
Again, a meditative silence fell over the man at the desk.
Then he threw aside his pose of hostility, as a man makes ready for work by throwing off his coat.
Sadie, how old are you?
He quickly inquired.
Good night, was the girl's grimly evasive answer.
You said your name was Wimple.
Have you any other?
None worth mentioning.
You mean, you're not a married woman?
Not on your life.
And never were.
A shadow crossed the pert young face under the Bendel hat.
Me for the single harness, she announced with a shrug.
He sat pondering her for a silent moment or two.
What nationality are you?
Come again, said the puzzled girl.
Are you a good American?
I won't gamble on the good. But ain't being just a moron about enough in times like these?
It's enough, acknowledged the man at the desk with a sigh.
But what I wanted to get at is, where did your parents come from?
Me mother was Irish.
And your father?
Search me.
The dew-lapped head moved slowly up and down.
Then came still another moment of silence.
Now, Sadie, there's a door you're keeping shut between the two of us.
A door?
Echoed the girl.
Yes, a door that you don't seem willing to open, a door that seems to lead out on other days.
He raised a heavy hand at the flash of alarm in her wide-open young eyes.
But I'm going to let that door stay shut, my girl. For as long as it stays that way, it needn't count with either one of us.
I don't quite get you, murmured the not altogether tranquil young woman.
And what's the game anyway, with all this third-degree stuff?
Have I seemed too inquisitive?
No. But when you get me thumbprints and me weight tubside, you'll just about have me record, won't you?
The chief smiled as he bent over the papers in front of him.
My dear girl, we've had your record here for the last 5 years.
That's part of our business.
Hully gee, said the girl, stiffening in the chair where she sat.
Then, furrowing her young brow, she craned apprehensively about at the intimidating sheets of closely written script.
But that's not the point, Sadie, pursued her inquisitor.
The point is that you're a remarkably clever young woman.
Sadie Wimple, under her rice powder, turned promptly and visibly pink.
Ah, chief, cut out the con.
But I mean it.
The girl shook her head.
I'm a mutt, and I know it.
And I've been as nervous as a cat since I breezed in here. For when you swivel chair boys throw a scare into me, I flop straight back to me 8-word talk. But plant me outside with the hotel broads, and I can pull the society stuff po' Ida Vernon look like an also-ran.
You're not only clever, Sadie, but you're attractive.
You're young and you're good to look at.
And the fact that you're a distinct deviation from type makes you especially valuable for the work we're going to lay out for you.
A secretarial-looking young man in glasses entered the room, and stepped softly to the chief's desk. There he murmured a discreet word or two, and as softly left the room. Chief Blinn's hand went out and touched a buzzer button on his desk end. Insignificant as that movement was, the girl's quick eye detected a valedictory note in it. "Then you are going to give me that work?" she asked as she rose to her feet. "That depends on your friend Kestner." "Where does Kestner come in?"
"He comes in through that door in 2 minutes. He and Wilsnock, in fact, are waiting out there to talk this case over with me."
"So Wilsnock's there too," said the girl, staring at the door.
"Yes, Sadie, but I've got to deny you the pleasure of seeing him. I want you to step out this other way and go straight back to your room at the Raleigh. Then I want you to wait there until I call you up. And tonight after dinner, either Shrub or Brubacher will come and explain just what has to be done." The heavy-bodied man was on his feet by this time, piloting her toward the door on the far side of the room. But the girl hung back for a moment.
"There's just one thing, Chief," she ventured, with a hand movement toward the written sheets on the desktop. "Have you got to put Wilsnock wise to all that dope there?"
"What dope?"
"About me black velvet past."
The chief laughed.
"That's an operative's report on the Warren Pearl smuggling case," he explained. "But in the matter of that door I happened to mention, I said it would stay shut, Sadie, and shut it stays."
"I get you," she announced as she passed out of the room. But flippant as her words were, there remained in them a tremulous note of gratitude. Chief Blinn swung about, still smiling, as the door on the opposite side of the room opened. The next moment, he was shaking hands with Kestner and Wilsnock of the Paris office.
"Kestner," the head of the service said as he sank into his swivel chair, "I want you to come back."
"My fighting days are over," announced the man who had said goodbye to the service. Yet he looked with no unfriendly glance at the ponderous face in which was set the shrewdest pair of eyes he had ever stared into.
"Then make this your last fight," almost pleaded the official, who plainly was not greatly given to petitioning for favors.
"Try the younger men," Kestner smilingly suggested. "Give Wilsnock here a chance on the case."
The man from the Paris office shifted a little uneasily.
"Wilsnock was on the case for a week," explained the chief, "and yesterday he asked me to wire for you."
There was open reproof in Kestner's glance at his colleague of other days.
"Wilsnock knows I came to America for quite another purpose," he explained, "for the somewhat personal, though trifling, purpose of getting married."
"My dear fellow, by all means get married," began the man at the desk.
But at once tear off on a beagle chase around the world after some verminous criminal with a weakness for 10-cent bedhouses and traveling steerage.
"This chase will not take you out of America," corrected Chief Blinn.
"That much I can guarantee.
But it will take me out of my club and my newer way of looking at things," explained the patient-eyed Kestner.
"You see, I seem to be developing a sort of philosophic sense of humor, and that leads to self-criticism, and that in turn keeps whispering to me that gumshoeing and gray hairs don't always go well together.
So what you want is peace with honor, the same as the rest of this country that's sleeping on a volcano."
"I've had enough of the volcano, at any rate."
"Well, for a family man who's tired of eruptions, I should think an embassy secretaryship, say Rome for 10 months, then London for a year, and then one of the quieter continental embassies itself, would be just about the right thing to keep the rust off."
Kestner turned and eyed the older man, but that older man disregarded his stare.
"This isn't loose talk, Kestner. We can't expect you to come back without making it worthwhile for you. But you know the way things stand with the administration. You know the Navy people can't afford to let much more of their stuff get out. And when you land your people, you'll get your post. That's as sure as taxes and death."
"You could do it inside of a month," prompted the bland-eyed Wilsnock.
"There are occasions," said the solemn-eyed Kestner, "when a month may seem a very long space of time. Isn't an ambassadorship sometimes worth 3 or 4 weeks of waiting?" inquired the man at the desk.
"I know a few guys who've worked 20 years for 'em. But I'm not working for ambassadorships.
Do you mean you don't even want one? Was the somewhat acidulated inquiry.
It's a great honor and a great opportunity, acknowledged Kestner. But when I work for my country, I don't do it with one hand in the pork barrel.
The chief's gesture was one of heavy impatience.
This thing's already been thought over and talked over. Foreign posts aren't passed around like trading stamps. They go to the men equipped for them. And from this year, those men are going to need greater equipment than flashing a gold-headed cane and writing sonnets. You know 7 or 8 languages, and you've covered Europe for 10 or 12 years. You've learned the lay of the land and served your country on some pretty big questions.
The big form leaned forward over the desk, and the big voice dropped to a more serious tone.
Kestner, that country needs you now. It needs you, as it never quite needed you before. And if you're the American one think you are, you're going to sidestep the tool and organ music for a few weeks and help this administration out of a hole.
A telephone call interrupted the chief's words, but never once did his eyes leave the other man's face.
Remember, it's not this newspaper war talk that's worrying us. We're 3 months ahead of that. And it's not the ship bombs and the factory burnings and the labor plots that are worrying us. We've got plenty of good workers to trail down the rest of that roughneck stuff. We can handle the Faye's and Von Papen's and Van Holmes and Loudon's and Scholes's easily enough, though we can't always holler out how much we know about 'em. But there's another gang operating over here that's getting on our nerves. For example, who told both Vienna and Berlin that we'd approach the Danish minister on the matter of the purchase of the Danish West Indies and gave the Germans a chance to set the Riksdag against the bill of session? Who surrendered our vacuum valve amplifier for picking up wireless to that same power? Who stole the Pearl Islands minefield maps for the protection of the canal? Who gave our new Fort Totten target firing records to the foreign agent who was taken off the New Amsterdam at Kirkwall and carried them in his shoe sole when arrested? And God knows what might happen before our next dreadnought gets off the stays. And I'm only telling you one half of what we're up against here, with this second underground band sneaking our data before it can even be reported to the department itself. You can pretty well see, I guess, what's got to be done by someone from this office. And I'm not the only man who thinks you ought to do it. You can count on the Secretary of the Navy, and what's more, you can count on the White House.
Wilsnock moved as though to break the silence, but Kestner stopped him. Then he turned to the thick-shouldered man at the desk.
Let me explain something to you, he began in his cool and even tones. You know what our work is. It's a bit like tiger shooting, seductive enough, but still dangerous. It has, as you say, a great deal of roughneck work, and now and then an occasional risk. When you're young, you're glad enough to face those risks. There's a thrill about it. But to keep on at it, once you're nearing 40, you've got to have a spark of youth that won't go out. You've got to nurse your streak of romance. Now the trouble is, I find my spark going out. The work doesn't seem romantic to me anymore. It seems nearly always humdrum, and very often underhand.
It's necessary work, interrupted the other.
So is scavenging. And I feel I've done about enough of it.
Then keep it up, persisted the chief, by helping us clear away this final mess.
But I'm tired of messes like this. I'm tired of the types they bring you in contact with. I'm tired of the way they have to be rounded up. I'm tired of crook warrens and gunplay and wiretapping. I want quietness and decency and an acre or two of lawn with a tennis court at one end and a Japanese tea house at the other.
Which is exactly what I've been trying to argue you into, promptly pointed out the chief.
You get all those things when you get your rosewood desk at the embassy, with a silk hat and a state carriage thrown in.
My experience with embassies, suggested Kestner, hasn't precisely fixed them in my mind as abodes of quietude.
But instead of stewing along the undercrust, you'll be a monument on the upper, said the chief, with a repeated heavy gesture that was almost one of impatience. And we can leave the embassies out, for we've got troubles closer than that. We've got one of the shrewdest
and completest systems of espionage ever organized to break up. As I've already told you, we've found leaks from the Navy and from the Aviation Corps. Our cipher codes have been stolen, and our wireless adaptations lifted. Our canal fortification plans have been dug out, and we know two different foreign powers are trying to get the secret of our new balanced turbines, to say nothing of the cross-torpedo, for which, we know beyond a doubt, one intelligence department has offered a cool million. And we have every reason to believe the whole business is being engineered by one of the trickiest foreign agents who ever bought a war map. Kestner sighed a little wearily. "And the gentleman's name?" he casually inquired. The chief was silent for a moment or two, as though weighing the expediency of making further confession to one still outside the service. Then he pulled out a drawer and tossed a mounted group photograph across the desk. "That's an enlargement from a moving picture film showing the crowd that watched the launching of our new submersible destroyer. We stumbled on it by accident. But in that crowd is one face, and if you look at it under the glass, you'll see the face of the man who's organized the entire system that we've got to beat. That's about all we know, beyond the fact, apparently, that he's working with foreign people he's brought over for the purpose, people unknown to our operatives here." "But who's the man?" repeated Kestner, running a casual eye along the welter of closely crowded figures on the mounted picture. "Kudel," was the chief's answer. Kestner's hand dropped to the desktop. "Kudel?" he echoed, a trifle vacuously, as he took up the picture and searched through its serried faces with a narrowing eye. "Then you've heard the name?" inquired the chief. "Yes, I've heard the name," was Kestner's slowly enunciated answer. "And even Wilsnock here will recognize the face, I imagine."
"You mean you know the man?"
"Do we know him, Wilsnock?" Kestner asked, turning to his colleague bent low over the photograph.
"That's Kudel," cried out the younger man.
"I'd swear it."
"And what do you know about him?" asked Blinn, turning back to Kestner.
"For one thing, that I hate him the same as a woman hates a snake."
"Why?"
Kestner's answer was neither so prompt nor so direct as it might have been. "Because embodied in him is everything about this life that made it and still makes it odious to me."
"Does that mean," asked the chief as he watched Kestner restore the photograph to the desktop, "that we're not to count on you in this case?" Kestner stared for a meditative moment or two at the Washington Monument. Then he turned back to the man at the desk.
"I'm not the man for this case. But I know the people it belongs to. And I can at least start those people right."
"What people?" asked the chief.
"Wilsnock here for one.
And the other is a young woman named Sadie Wimple."
"Why this young woman?"
"Because she knows Kudel the same as a keeper knows a diamondback." The heavy-shouldered man behind the desk was already on his feet.
"Then supposing we talk to the Secretary of the Navy for 5 or 10 minutes, he suggested. "And then we'll see if we can't get in to the President himself for a few minutes." The other two men had already risen.
"The first thing we ought to do," explained Kestner, "is to round up Sadie Wimple."
"That," announced the chief as he crossed to the inner door, "should not be a difficult matter."
"Do you happen to know Sadie?" Kestner asked.
"Sadie Wimple, gentlemen, is already engaged on this case," announced the chief, with a pardonable note of pride in his voice. "And tomorrow, as Madame Fatichiara, the world-renowned astrologist, I might add, she will be doing the decoy duck act just off Broadway."
Chapter 2. It was 6 days after his conference in Washington that Kestner was breakfasting in his rooms overlooking San Diego Bay. He had his reasons for privacy, and nursed no inclination apparently to mingle with the gayer company thronging the wide verandas and corridors of that huge hostelry, which seemed to exist only for laughter and music and dancing and lovemaking. Yet the table was laid for two, and as Kestner sat before his iced cassava, he might have been seen to glance repeatedly and impatiently down at his watch. His look of anxiety, in fact, did not pass away
until a telephone bell rang and the hotel office announced the arrival of Lieutenant Keyes.
"I'm sorry to be late," proclaimed this young lieutenant, as Kessner admitted him and at the same moment dismissed the waiter. The newcomer, who bore a startling resemblance to Wilsnock of the Paris office, inspected the laden breakfast table with evident relief. It was, however, a rejuvenated Wilsnock, an airy and summery Wilsnock in white cricketer's flannel, carrying a roll-brim Panama and a bamboo swagger stick. But to rig out in this get-up takes time. Kessner, as they took their seats, cast a somnolently critical eye over his younger colleague.
"You'll do," he finally announced.
"But just why am I Lieutenant Keyes?" inquired the man in cricketer's flannel.
"Because, my dear fellow, your arrival has been duly heralded in the evening papers," Kessner announced,
"and there are one or two persons, quite outside official circles, who are rather interested in your new warplane."
"My new warplane?"
"Yes, which you have brought with you from the Brooklyn Navy Yard. At least the specifications are now with you." Kessner handed an oblong packet of papers across the table to his inquiring-eyed colleague.
"Then you've actually been finding something out?"
Wilsnock asked.
"I've found out quite a number of things," was Kessner's quiet-toned answer, as he squeezed a slice of lemon over his fried sand dabs. "And not the least important is the fact that Wallaby Sam is working with Kudel."
Wilsnock looked up in astonishment.
"That's a sweet pair to have against us," he solemnly affirmed.
"But this seems to be only a sideshow," Kessner explained. "The main top, we must remember, is back in New York. It's only outpost work we're doing here, Wilsnock, for it's Sadie they've planted at the center of things."
A shadow crossed Wilsnock's face.
"But will it be safe for that girl, working alone there?"
Kessner smiled.
"You'd rather have her here?" he inquired.
"Couldn't she help us out, on a case like this?"
"But this case, Wilsnock, is off the main line.
And you needn't worry about Sadie Wimple not being able to take care of herself. In the meantime, however, we've got our own work cut out for us."
"Along what lines?"
"I'm not quite sure myself yet. You see, I've had to keep under cover and remain a purely nocturnal animal, so to speak. And that's counted against me."
"Why undercover?"
"Because one of the facts I've dug out is that the sweet-scented couple we spoke of a moment ago have got Anna Mockife operating for them, and operating right here in this hotel."
"Mockife?"
cogitated Wilsnock.
"That name's new to me."
"Well, it isn't to me, and I've had the dictaphone annunciator on the end of this jointed bamboo fishing pole covering her window every night it was open."
"Where does she come from?"
"Her father was an anglicized Pole, and her mother a music hall singer in Paris. She was trained for the stage herself, but married before she was 20. Then she went to India with an English army officer who knew nothing of her antecedents. There she hitched up with a Russian Grand Duke and ran away to the Orient, where she was soon deserted and had to live by her wits. Kudel found her there when he was buying up German coast defense data, and took her to Vienna, where she learned two or three more languages, and how to dress, and a few of the tricks of the international spy trade. She was 4 years in Petrograd, and those 4 years, I'd venture, cost the Russian government a good many million rubles in military leaks. Then she rather dropped out of things for a few years, for she actually fell in love with a young artist, and stuck to him like a burr until the family railroaded the boy out of the country. Today she's an exceptionally adroit and attractive woman of the panther type, at the dangerous age of 30, and with her claws this time set in the flesh of a Lieutenant Colonel Deems out here."
"And has Deems been?"
Wilsnock seemed reluctant to put his fellow officer's fall into words.
"I'm afraid so."
"Poor devil."
"Yes, poor devil, for he has a wife and two children at Wilmington, and Shrub wires me they're the right sort."
"And does the Mockife woman dream you're on her trail?"
"Naturally not, or she'd even let Deems out of her claws to get away. It makes me sick to see that poor devil dancing about with her. He's like a man in a trance."
"Could she care for him?"
not a rap. What she's after is Navy information. Why she had possession of every detail of our L1, 10 days after.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.